All right, thank you. All right, my name is Joe Mochnik. I would like to warmly welcome you to Hey Library today. So excited. So I don't remember when was the last time that we had an event and it got totally, let's call it, sold out. So we booked this place and we have two overflow rooms. So hello, if you're in one of the overflow rooms, I would like to welcome you to this streaming and live event that is going to go on. I'm going to briefly introduce our speaker, Mutale Nkonde. How does that sound? Good, thank you. And then I'm going to move myself out of it and Mutale is going to take over. So let me first start with thanking three individuals who really were the brain power behind this idea to have our third library lecture series focused on artificial intelligence. So Jason, would you mind standing up, please? Jason Coleman, Alice Anderson. And we have Carol Seven, who is in Hawaii. Good for her. So we have a group of individuals in the library who focus heavily on AI, artificial intelligence, and at least for a couple of years, they have kind of put their foot forward and said, well, what is this AI thing? What should we do with it? How could we apply it? And I think instead of, you know, when you see major obstacles, you have the temptation to run away from it. I think we have a group of people in the library who runs towards it and have, together with much, much larger group of individuals right now in the library, we have a really solid cohort who is actively pursuing artificial intelligence, especially artificial intelligence literacy and some other aspects to figure out how can the libraries, how can we here at K-State help our students, faculty, researchers, perhaps community, because we are a land-grant institution, to really achieve some of this wonderful accomplishments as we utilize this pretty sophisticated, fairly disruptive tool and find a way how to utilize these things. I would like to thank the entire library staff. Special thanks go to our marketing department and many other folks who have helped out with this. Let me acknowledge the significant dignitaries here. We have a Vice President for Diversity, Equity, Inclusion, and Belonging here. Thank you so much for joining us. If there are any other deans, VPs, and such, please, I'm very appreciative that you're here or online for joining us, and thank you for all of us, for the rest of you who is joining us. So today, we welcome Mutale Nkonde, a visiting policy fellow at the Oxford Internet Institute and CEO of AI for the People, a nonprofit focused on using popular culture on promoting policies, understanding algorithmic bias. I tried this three times, it's not easy. She has been a fellow, not easy to pronounce, just imagine how hard it is to do it, okay? She has been a fellow at Stanford University Digital Civil Society Lab, Harvard University's Berkman Klein Center for Internet and Society, and Notre Dame's Institute for Advanced Study. In her capacity as AI policy advisor to Congresswoman Yvette Clark, Nkonde contributed to the drafting of the Algorithmic Accountability Act and Deep Fakes Accountability Act and the No Biometrics Barriers to Housing Act. Nkonde's writings have been published in the Harvard Business Review, the Harvard African American Policy Journal, Miss Magazine, the New York Times, and the Washington Post. She earned a bachelor's degree in sociology from the Leeds Metropolitan University and a master's degree in American Studies from Columbia University. After the lecture, we'll have time for a brief question and answer period before we adjourn to the fifth floor gallery for wine and hors d'oeuvres. I would just like, before I welcome Mutale to speak, we were just exchanging, we lived together at the same time in 1990s in London. So I was kind of in North London and she lived in North London. So we have kind of might have seen each other in a previous century or millennium. So I would like warmly to welcome Mutale Nkonde here to K-State.
Oh my goodness. I don't know about you, but I'm one of these people who I'm always scared that I'm going to have a party and nobody shows up. So I am very honored and excited to be here today. So I'm going to do a couple of things over the next hour. I'm going to introduce you to myself, some of the work that I've been doing, some of the questions that have been raised, and then I'm hopefully going to get into conversation with you all, because that's by far the most exciting and important part of the lecture for me. So if you'll just bear with me whilst you take a journey into my brain, and then we can go. So the reason I've put up this slide is public interest technology is a field that the large foundations, specifically coming out of New York and California, have been thinking to ground over the last 5 or so years. And the idea is, like we have a public interest media system where the information that you should expect to receive there is fair and balanced and pro-social, we have a public sector law, public interest law sector, where those that cannot afford representation can get it for free, that as we move forward into what we are in now, which is an information age, and AI being only one of the tools that we'll use in that information age, you're going to have people that look at technological development, governance, but do it within the public interest. And the interesting thing for me is I've worked in this field around 15 years before it had that name. And before AI was AI too, because it's based on computing principles that are older. But the reason I really wanted to start here was to really ground the conversation in the idea that these technologies are exciting and they're disruptive, and there is no reason that they need to be harmful as well. Even though I know that that's what a lot of the chat is, particularly in the media. So. Introduction, I'm going to go through a case study of my current work, unifying ideas, where algorithms come in. So there is going to be a little bit of engineering in this, but if you don't like math and you hate engineering, it's not going to be terrible. And if you do like math and you love engineering, it's going to be boring. But if you're somewhere in the middle, you'll stay with me. And then lastly, to go back to this grounding idea that technology, like any other field, can be in the public interest. So who am I? I sprang up in what is now the field of responsible AI around 2019, which I always call before times, because I feel like before COVID is probably like before Christ. Like, what happened then? We can't remember. It was so long ago. I wrote this paper along with sociologist Jesse Daniels, who's at City University New York, and computer scientist Derek Shin-Mayer. And what we were really looking to do in this paper was to try and understand why was technology so persistently racist? And what could we do to make it less so? And so back in those heady days of being an idiot, we were like, why don't we just do a little report and a checklist and it won't be racist anymore? It still is. We'll get into that later. But what this did was put out into the marketplace that technology can and should be better if you have lots of different people thinking about how that technology is developed. And even though I don't speak about DEI exclusively or specifically in this talk, you will keep hearing me make out these invitations for absolutely everybody in this room to be involved. So two of the foundations that read my report were the Ford Foundation and the MacArthur Foundation. I never heard of either. That's another consistent theme. I never really know what's going on. I'm always like, wait, what's that? And they basically said, would you like to start an organization? And I said, as a joke, I would love to start an organization, because the way that these engineers are, the way that these technologies are engineered are not for people. And they said to me, you know, well, what would you call it? And I said, AI for the people is a joke. And they were like, that's great. And then they gave me a check. And I was like, that is great. And so I now run a nonprofit. I was just, you know, alone, kind of screaming into the wilderness, telling people not to make technology racist. And then NASDAQ were like, we think you're doing great work, that VCs of all people really want to integrate into their investment portfolio. Will you come to NASDAQ? I live in New York City. And even though I knew what NASDAQ was, and I knew that it had a bell, and I knew that I would have a really big picture on the side of, I just seemed to ignore that and send the first picture that came up, you know, when you attach, which is this one. But it was just so strange to be in a situation where you're ringing a bell to tell a bunch of people to make less money so that they can make better technology. But it happened to me, it can happen for you all. That is America. So I do advise a number of companies, TikTok being one. I can definitely speak to you about that. Poor TikTok. I hope it works out for them. But I tried. Google is another one, which you may have heard of, and I'll speak about that later. But the interesting thing about Google was, initially, when I kind of came into the Google world, they were really mad that I was saying racism is technology. Now they're not, so they're back. So that's good. And one of the things that is really important for the students in this room and the non-students is that we are in a knowledge economy, so we have to keep thinking. So I recently found out that I will be starting a PhD at Cambridge in the fall, which is hilarious to me because I've been to a bunch of universities, but in this particular university, you join a college and a university. So I nearly didn't get in because they offered me the place and then I ignored the emails. And then they were like, no, you need to come to a college. Like, and I was like, wait, for real? Okay. So I'll be doing that. And I can certainly talk about that for other people who consider themselves to be lifelong learners and really the economy that we're going towards. So what I'm going to do is just take you through a case study of the type of work that I do in public interest tech. And I'm specifically very interested in working with social media companies and what they call their policy and trust and safety teams. So even though I meant to start this talk thanking the library, I clearly got nervous and not doing that. But thank you to all the library staff. I really appreciate you. But what I appreciate them more than the invitation to come here are some of the questions that they need to ask about information integrity constantly. That same work is done within social media companies. And when we think about that work being done in social media companies, we're thinking about, is the information true? Is the information harmful? How can we make sure that it spreads? How can we make sure that it doesn't spread? And one of the things that I certainly did on January 6th as an American was, number one, I could not believe what was happening. I really did think it was a movie for some reason. But number two, I looked at the crowd and I said, I knew three things were happening. I knew that there had been social media organizing because that's one of the principal ways that we're exchanging ideas. I knew that obviously this is a historical moment, as you all knew, but as I looked into the crowd, I was like, oh, there are no Black people here. Okay, nothing to do with me. Not really. That did not turn out to be the case. And the case study I'm gonna take you through is how algorithmically, even the things that you think you do know can be changed in those environments through decisions that we make or we don't make around information. So the first person that really came to me as I was looking at January 6th and I was trying to think, what would inspire this group of Americans to make these serious sets of decisions? And why, who were the Americans and why weren't other Americans there? Enrico Tarrio came up. And the thing that's really interesting about Enrico Tarrio is this guy in the middle with the vest on. He's Afro-Cuban. He was the chairman of the Proud Boys. And if you don't know who the Proud Boys were, I mean, it's all over the news, but highlights, street gang, just don't do it, kids. Like, just don't do it, not good. But in order to be a Proud Boy, one of the things that you had to do was say that white supremacy was the supreme law of the land. And I was like, well, that's great for you if you're a Proud Boy and if that's what you want to do. But Enrique, really? Why are you there? So what was really interesting about him is that he had, through these social and technical interactions, been able to make this leap. He ultimately got sentenced for 22 years in federal prison for masterminding seditious conspiracy for his role that day. And even at sentencing, he completely used contestable information as a defense. The next thing that made me really interesting, as from a social media perspective, I was looking at, well, how are we creating truth? And who were the people behind this? I came across this guy, Ali Alexander, who is a fascinating creature, definitely, I shouldn't say, fascinating man. I'm not being rude about this man. But prior to this, he did something that I recommend nobody here does. He went to social media to admit that he was committing crimes. Now, if you are criminally inclined, this isn't advice, this is just from me to you, human to human, don't go to social media and tell us because you will be investigated. But he made a series of videos, all of which were variations of, I created the Stop the Steal hashtag, it is mine, there is gonna be this great march, and if anybody tries to say that they did this, know that I did it. The problem with that was when he was talking about creating a hashtag, what that actually means in engineering terms, we think of a hashtag from what we see on the outside of the website. So you see the pound sign and then a phrase. Algorithmically, what happens is that that phrase is translated into a line of code. And then those particular markers are used by people like me, I told you I'm getting this degree in digital humanities, but then people like me would then use that unique code to start to understand who is using this, who are they following, what actions do they take, where do they live, what do they like, and we build these statistical models of the type of people that would engage in this. Another really famous hashtag that I'm sure we all know is Black Lives Matter. So it would be that same use of a hashtag that has this social meaning, but this digital footprint. He actually wasn't at the riot of January 6th, but he was asked to testify in front of the House because he had very kindly told us that this was all him, only him. If anybody asked about me, it was me. So that was very nice. But what was really interesting in both these two case studies is that these were leaders of a movement that was not largely Black, but they were Black. So this really set off my wheel spinning because I was interested to find out what was going on from an AI perspective, what was going on algorithmically that would drive these people to to this fate. So we're gonna watch a really, really small part of this video. If you're interested, I definitely recommend that you look at it, but it's the lead up that kind of underscores what I'm saying, because this is a huge question across the humanities, across the digital humanities, and within industry, particularly as we prepare to go to the polls.
We dig now again into a study that's happened about the January 6th Capitol insurrection. Of the nearly 400 American rioters who were arrested or charged, 93% are white and 86% are male. That's according to the Chicago Project on Security and Threats. Here's Michelle Martin speaking to the study's principal investigator, Professor Robert Pape at the University of Chicago, with some surprising revelations about the attackers and their motives.
Professor Robert Pape, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Now, you said from the beginning, it's important to understand who stormed the Capitol on January 6th. And by that, you don't just mean for the purpose of bringing criminal charges. You've analyzed information about more than 400 people who've been arrested so far. And I'm being sort of vague about the number because the number changes, you know, every day. You know, some of the people have been in the news, like the guy with the fur hat, you know, the guy putting his feet on the speaker's desk. But you saw that there are patterns. The first thing, some things that anybody who was actually watching the thing unfold could see: overwhelmingly white, overwhelmingly male. We could also see that they're older. What was the kind of overall sort of profile of the person who got involved?
What's so striking in this case is two-thirds of...
Oh no, okay, he does great work, but we're not gonna get into it right now because we've only got an hour. But what is really interesting about that is as we think about how those people get to January 6th, and he picks out a number of ideas which we then able to see in the data. So the first idea that Pape really picks out is, no matter who stormed the Capitol that day, in his surveying, they all had a negative view of immigrants. In their view, people that were emigrating to this country, whether it be legally or otherwise, extra legally, were stealing. There was something really negative about this. And that was one of the reasons that drove them to DC that day, because they really feared for their future. And I would encourage that we do really sit in the compassion of that, because there is nothing worse than feeling scared and you don't feel in control. And this is the way, this was one of the ways that people were getting their agency. The second thing, and this is kind of where my interest comes in, is the places in which they were expressing this. They weren't just saying it to each other or meeting each other in various places. They were going online. And as we think about our new online environment, specifically after ChatGPT and the invention of that, and what that technology does is that it will take an idea that you've given it and then build on that idea. What would it mean in 2024 for that same thing to happen in a post-ChatGPT environment? And the reason that that's really interesting to me is that you would effectively potentially have the machine finishing your thought. So if you came to it with anti-immigrant ideas, what would it say? What would be the impact of this? And what happens when this happens at scale? Because even though we're the only ones interacting with the technology, the messages that go out become globalized messages. The larger theoretical driver is something called the Great Replacement Theory, which is where a lot of my research actually lies. And the really fascinating thing about the Great Replacement Theory is that when we look to the data, you can switch it out. The reason that Enrique Tarrio can show up as a Proud Boy is that they can switch off the race part and switch on something else. The reason that Ali Alexander was so comfortable in his role with Stop the Steal was that if you looked at his interviews, it was really about jobs. And the thing that makes it so pertinent and scary, if this is the way that we're going to be using algorithmic systems like social media, is that we're in a massive moment of economic and social transformation in this country. I was so excited to hear that you're a land grant institution, because if we look at the land grant program after the Civil War, it was really developed to provide the new knowledge needed as the United States was moving away from being an agrarian society and becoming an industrialized society. We're in that same type of moment now, except we're moving away from being a manufacturing and service-based economy and towards a knowledge-based economy. And so these same fears around people are taking our jobs, I'm not gonna have a future, being with technologies that can really reinforce some negative or toxic conversations coming online are really scary, at least to people like me. So we were looking into that data, and I just could not get out of my mind that the leaders of this kind of Stop the Steal January 6th, some of those leaders were Black men. And I went to look at a survey by a group called the Public Religion Research Institute. I pretty much don't think that I put their right acronyms on there, but okay. And the reason for that is part of my work really intersects with religious studies. And they'd done the survey in 2022 around the Great Replacement Theory, where they were asking if people agreed or disagreed with this idea that immigrants were invading the country. They found that Americans that trusted news sources, 80% of respondents felt that way, QAnon believers, 65%, Republicans, 60%, Democrats, 11%, Independents, 26%. The reason that that is really significant to me is that it shows you that across the political spectrum, this fear that something is being taken from us exists. And that's mainstream. But when we think about what this belief does on the extremities, this is a picture of Dylann Roof, who in 2015 shot 9 African-American people while they were at Bible study. He was completely radicalized online. This is actually a picture that was taken from his Facebook page. It wasn't removed. I can speak about the ethics of that later. Another person that really, really believed in this Great Replacement Theory is this guy that we've already referenced here with the horns. He considered himself the QAnon shaman, and after storming the Capitol, actually went to prayer in the dais and thanked, called Jesus's name and was like, this is, you know, no shirt, I'm here, we're doing it. again, algorithmically radicalized. And this young man, I may say his name incorrectly, so do forgive me, but Peyton Graydon was the man that went to Buffalo, New York and shot 10 people while they were shopping. And again, this idea of the great replacement was there. What is really key about the three of these is that all of this happened online. This is not people in their communities telling them this. This is not, if you looked at the FBI track, all of this stuff happened online. So in the slide before, where I was showing you 60% of these people, 30% of those people, that first slide, that was us. It was people like us that were surveyed. But this is what happens when toxic messaging gets into large language models, and then it gets to the extremes. So why is this a responsible AI problem? So going back to this idea that technology can be done in the public interest, going back a little bit into my career and what I've looked at, I've been really interested in thinking from an engineering perspective and from a social science perspective, how do we maintain free speech and maintain political balance online while at the same time protecting from these messages that we know to be toxic? So on the left of the screen, if you do not know this book, you should certainly know this book. Sophia Noble is a professor at UCLA. She is the winner of the 2021 MacArthur Genius Award for this book, Algorithms of Oppression. And the key takeaway from this book is that when we think about online search, we are searching advertising platforms. We are not searching for knowledge. So I'm sure my library professionals are really happy that I'm saying this, but it's true. She's also an information scientist, that's her PhD. But in Algorithms of Oppression, she was able to show how through search engine optimization, particular search terms will bring up toxic results. In her particular case study, she was looking at the way young women are looked at online. All the news is bad, by the way, the top line. I don't need to ruin it for you, but it's particularly bad if you're a Black young woman. It's particularly bad if you're an Asian young woman, and she really goes down to the data. This next picture, which I couldn't get to be clearer, is the reason for that to happen. So a lot of my work really looks at thinking how can we use recommendation algorithms to not push us into these darker parts of the internet that make being online a dangerous place at worst and a place that sucks at best. So an algorithm is a software program, it's proprietary, and it gives technologies the ability to either make predictions or make decisions. And that ability for a technology to make a prediction or to make a decision is what makes it artificially intelligent. So when you think about the term AI, you should also think about the fact that you are thinking about a machine that can engage in a cognitive task. So if people have voice assistants, they're often telling their voice assistants, I don't know why you all are doing this. I clearly am a tech phobe and live behind a tree and only speak to people in person and write notes because of my work. But many people are saying to their voice assistant, pay for this, show me this song, give me this. And the reason it's able to do that is because of this engineering process, these algorithms. The same for people who are opening their phones with their faces, another crazy thing, keep your face to yourself, it's very valuable, don't do it. And other all these small ways that we're using AI and training AI in our lives every day. If you're liking things on social media, that's another way that you are engaging with an AI system and you are actually training and making that system better. So if you're the user, this person here, what you would do is that you go onto your phone and you're like, I like this picture. I like this picture. I like this movie. Show me this. And what that does is go into this black box, which is a recommendation system, and it starts to make a model of you. And it says, Mutale is the type of person that watched Love is Blind, that really likes pizza from this particular place, and drives a Prius. What will happen is that becomes a statistical model of the type of person I am, and what is fed back to me are ads of Priuses. If you ever done this where you've gone online and you were like, how do they know? How did Facebook know I love Uggs? You're being tracked. So it will feed back to me ads and messages that align with my wants and needs. It could also feed back to me things like immigrants are bad, you better go get to, I mean, my friend Ali Alexander, it could be like, oh, look, stop the steal. Look at this inconvenient, hey, this is where all your friends are gonna be January 6th. And it can lead to negative behaviors. This is happening at scale. And what I mean is everybody all over the world is doing this all of the time. And it's pushing us into sectors of the internet where everybody looks, feels, says what we do, which sounds utopian, but in actual fact, the way that human beings, the way that natural intelligence is different from human intelligence is that we have values. We can apply compassion. We can apply notions of justice. We can also say no. Algorithmic recommendation systems are automatic. Decisions are made in a flash. One of the key important factors of decision making is time. And the reason that artificial intelligence and artificially intelligent systems will never supersede human intelligence, and at best, in my view, should be tools. It should be people, humanity working with machines, not machines working on behalf of humanity, is because if you are making decisions devoid of what it means to be a human being, you're gonna make a bunch of bad decisions. And a few slides ago, Enrique Tarrio is definitely somebody who got into the chat rooms. He got into the group chat, went crazy, 22 years in federal prison, so don't be that guy. Now, teams like mine would look at those case studies and we would think about, as practitioners of responsible AI, what could have happened differently to de-radicalize people? And I'm only using Tarrio and Ali, is that they're really good examples of people that worked against their own interests. They were leaders of white supremacist movements while being Black. Crazy. So what we would look at was, is the system fair? Is the system reliable and safe? And what we mean by that is, if those conditions were to happen again, 2024 is coming up, would it replicate? Are these systems privacy protecting and secure? I made a joke about Siri, but the truth of it is, you actually don't know where your preference data is going. You don't know where it's being sold to. There is a really good example of, I'm doing some reading for another project where they were looking at a homelessness algorithm that was built to get people off the street. And in order for unhoused people to use this, they had to get consent to their data being shared with 168 agencies, two of which were the FBI and their local police. But if you don't have a house, listen, the FBI probably already, hi FBI, like they already know about me. I'm all over the internet. It is what it is. But if it was a difference between having a house and not having a house, that's not a fair question to ask. We would ask around privacy and security. We're always going to ask about inclusivity. And the reason for that is, if you do read Professor Noble's book, which I recommend, one of the key interventions for making recommendation systems better is making sure that we're all involved in that process. And her argument is, if more women were involved in developing online search, then maybe more girls would be safe on the internet, because there should be somebody in that room advocating for that group. We would look at transparency, which we don't have. None of us actually know how the Google algorithm works, how the TikTok algorithm works. And that's because that's proprietary information. I can certainly speak about that later. That's a big question within the legal community. And then, is it accountable? And a lot of the work that I do is in policy. And one of the things that we're always thinking about is, can you hold a machine accountable for inciting a riot if it was algorithmic recommendation systems? And at the UN level, that's one of the big questions being asked by the Rohingya people who were massacred in 2018. And the way in which the Facebook recommender worked was that it whipped up all of this anti-Rohingya sentiment, much like the great replacement theory stuff that we've discussed. The report that I alluded to earlier, which was my checklist, has been a constant in my own work. And one of the things that I always think about, no matter what algorithmic system I'm looking at, is my concern are Black American communities online. I am a Black person living in America. I really want to be safe online. I do sometimes tip onto the internet, and I don't want anybody's mess. And I'm not going to fight with people. I do not fight with strangers online. If that's you, stop that. That's dumb. But I also don't want to be driven to that point. And the lens that I use is always this three-part, these three questions. When I look at an algorithmic system, I think to myself, has this system been designed with the knowledge that everything that goes on in the United States is inculcated with our history, and part of that is a history of race and racism? An example of that was when ChatGPT-3 was released, I wrote an article, I can't remember the outlet, but about the knowledge gaps within ChatGPT-3, because I had asked ChatGPT-3, how did Bessie Jackson influence Mahalia? How did Bessie Smith influence Mahalia Jackson? Now, in my household, the places that I know, we all know Mahalia Jackson because we all go to church, which is why when you said good morning, you all were supposed to say, well, good morning or good afternoon. But what was really interesting was ChatGPT did three things to let me know that it was not designed with histories of race. Bessie Jackson was the first person in American history to ever get a recording contract in 1920. It was $1,500, it was Columbia Records, and the music that she wrote has influenced Elvis Presley, Janis Joplin, I'm trying to think, and now I'm ChatGTP, how embarrassing. But I know she influenced those two, as well as Beyonce. And so to not know who Bessie Smith is and say you know about music is really like in this era to say, you only know Taylor Swift, but you've never seen Beyonce. You're clearly crazy because they're all over everything. But the question that I asked was about influence. I asked about her power. The response I got was, she was born in this state, she did this, she didn't do the other. So then I wrote to the people at OpenAI and said, why don't you know? And it didn't say anything about Mahalia Jackson, who's an amazing gospel singer. And my question was, why don't you know about the power and the influence that women have had in American society, specifically Black women? And they wrote back to me and said, we did not train our data set to see women as powerful. And I said, you should. So that was an example of a cognitive hole within ChatGPT, a technology that we think knows everything, and it didn't know that. The other thing that you've got to think about when you are thinking through a racially literate lens is, how do we even have this conversation? Particularly in an environment where there is an immense backlash against anything that's progressive, but certainly diversity, equity. Thank you. Certainly diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging. But the reason that that becomes really hard is those are the ways in which we can really open up that conversation. Those are the ways that we can ask, why isn't this person in your lab? Why wouldn't you think that these people are intelligent? Why wouldn't you contribute? Even I've been speaking to the team that brought me here today. I live in New York City, and I speak long, so I'm not gonna tell you this crazy story about me coming from New York City to Manhattan today. It was insane. But one of the things that it pointed out to me was I had to take two planes. I had to have a 4-hour layover. And then the plane didn't, the second plane, Wisconsin Airlines, yes, I said you, it's been recorded, whatever, it was true, didn't have a tracker. And I was like, I have never been on a plane to San Francisco where it doesn't have it. Like, why is this so difficult? And the truth of it is, it's difficult because people that live in Kansas are not thought of being part of the knowledge economy. How dumb does that sound? How dumb does that sound? And the reason I say how dumb does that sound was that I was in casual conversation, and now I'm finding all of these things I did not know about agricultural tech. And I was like, well, if we're going to have national stability, we're going to need food. So we probably should speak to the people in Kansas, because they seem to know a lot over here at KU about that particular subject. But in the environments and in the rooms I'm in, whether it's DC, whether I'm in San Francisco, whether I'm in LA, whether I'm in London, whether I'm in Paris, whether I'm in all of these places, they're never thinking about regional voices. They're never thinking about the people that live in our country that have innate knowledge that are not in the conversations. So when I think about DEI, I'm also not just thinking about race. I'm thinking about everybody who's excluded from every single conversation and has the right to be in it. And then the last thing, and this is my call to you all, is once you know that you're living in an environment in which some people are valued and some people are not, my passion, my interest is in making sure that Black people, specifically Black feminized people, are valued within their spaces. Your passion and your interest might be something else, and I encourage it to be something else, because every single person has to do the work of progress, is my view. Once you know that, and you're going to make sure that those people show up in those spaces, once you know that this is going to be a difficult conversation, so you're going to have to build alliances and allegiances around difference to make sure that there is inclusion and make sure that allies are part of that. I've spent probably about 30 minutes talking to you. How can KSU contribute? What is unique about your community? What is unique about you? What is special about these students in this geography at this time? And how can you make sure that you're part of the conversation? Because I have had a long, illustrious career. I am blessed beyond measure, and it's only getting better. Nobody ever invited me to any of those parties, and I didn't care. I showed up. I took space. And one of the reasons that I took space was to make space. So I'm hoping that as we get into this discussion, and I can speak more about the engineering, I can speak less about the engineering, that you really think of yourselves as being part of an economy in which we want to maintain our humanity, but get maximum benefit from AI projects, whether it is, you know, obviously I'm known for being a Debbie Downer, so obviously I brought the January 6th example, but they're good examples which I can show you. But whether we are thinking about communications technologies, food technologies, whether we're thinking about the ways in which we learn, the ways in which we, the ways in which we congregate, AI systems are going to be used as tools in every single one of those domains. And the thing that I wouldn't want any of you to think is that you sit outside of that economy and that growth just because people don't think you are there, because nobody thought that I should be there either. And at least for the next academic year, I'm going to be a fellow at Oxford, and I'm going to be a student at Cambridge, and I will be the first person in history to hold those accolades at the same time. So thank you. So that is my final slide. If you didn't take anything away, if you didn't take anything else away, just know that we created these technologies, and so we have the power to make sure that they work for us, because AI certainly should be for the people.
Okay, thank you so much for your presentation. We have time for a few questions. We have a couple of mics coming around. Jason is over there at the back, and we're going to try to answer any questions. All right.
Hi, can you hear me from here?
Yes.
I'm a chemical engineering PhD student, and I'm actively working on AI systems for agriculture and food systems. Mm-hmm. And I have a question regarding AGI, which is going to be the next generation of AI mm-hmm. that is going to eliminate the dependence of AI on human data. So how do you think that will affect the whole algorithmic bias of controlling societies and more?
I don't think that AGI, first of all, I think much of the claims around AI are hype. And I would really love to see an architectural, a technical architecture of what it means to have a non-human data set. The systems that I look at and the systems that I study are around computer-human interactions. So since you're a food person, are you thinking about AGI in food systems? Because I know in biomedical spheres, for example, they still do use human data sets, but the impact of the AI isn't as, it doesn't interrupt fundamental rights. So the second part of your question is, how do you think this will impact human bias or algorithmic bias? I don't think the invention of AGI is going to stop racism. So I think I'll be fine. I'll have stuff to do.
Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Jane Turner. I'm a senior in mechanical engineering. First of all, I'd like to thank you for being here. It was a fabulous talk, and I really appreciate how you're able to talk about these very difficult subjects in an impartial way and with compassion. That's a really, especially with these very hard topics we hit, something that's very, very challenging. And so this is a little more pertinent to your subject matter expertise. Sorry, I had to write it down so I remembered. So something you talked about earlier in the talk is how these radical ideas, the Great Replacement, or the the Syrian group you mentioned earlier, and I feel bad for not remembering their names, but I remember when it was happening, it was very distressing, and how those initial ideas, you know, probably were introduced to this sphere, the online sphere, by humans, and then AI grew it and cultivated it, and you know, people chose to make actions mm-hmm. on these online environments. So one, how how many very radicalized people do you really need to like kind of like set off an idea, like a seed? Like how much catalyst do you need? And are we also concerned, and then the second question is, are we concerned about AIs themselves introducing these ideas? And then
that's a great question. So I'm just going to go back to this slide, which gets to the first part of your question. The Great Replacement Theory, whether you agree with it or disagree with it, only remains in the theoretical realm, even within the 80% that believe it, the 11%, the 26% when it's not acted upon. I think I don't believe in banning or pushing or banning people from social media. I do not believe in social media cancellation. I think that we live in a free speech environment, and so that's not appropriate. However, we can degrade, my view would be we can kind of degrade or just not allow dangerous ideas to rise to the top of For You feeds if you're on TikTok or people's homepages, because ideas when they're not acted upon are just ideas. The issue, I think, is the environment that those ideas create for the targeted groups. And if we are going to be a country that is open and inclusive as demographics change, then we potentially do not want to make ideas like the great replacement theory just kind of be standard cause. A big thing about Dr. Noble's book, Algorithms of Oppression, was that she was making this argument that we need online environments that welcome young women, because young women are not only online, but there are more young women actually being educated in universities, which means women are much more likely to be part of the knowledge economy. And so they need to be able to research and do all of these wonderful things online and still not be attacked. So I think the first part is a theory is a theory until it's acted upon, but it only takes one person to kill 9 people. They had their eyes closed. They were at Bible study. They were unarmed. They said that they loved him before they killed him. And I'm not going to do all the other clicking, because all of the people that I mentioned did horrible, terrible things, particularly the one who's breaks my heart. Like, all of these case studies of extremism break my heart, because they don't only target innocent people, but they also ruin that person's life. And the last example of the guy that went to the supermarket, he drove 200 miles. He killed people in their 80s. He was 18. I have a 17-year-old daughter who's about to go to college, and she's definitely an idiot. I love her, but her decision-making is not there. But she's a kind and she's a good person, and she would never hurt anybody. And what has gone wrong, you know, in those people's lives? So when you say how many extremists, for me, it only takes one. And it makes me wonder what could, I'm a huge reader. So I'm thinking of the play, Journey of a Salesman, I think I might have got, where they all contributed to the death. And it's like, what could we have done as the society to hold these people? I haven't really talked about gender in this talk, but in those initial slides, it was men. How is masculinity being constructed? How can we pull men in as jobs are, you know, jobs are going, the economy's crazy after COVID. So what can be done? I think society needs to make shifts. And then from a product design process, which was another part of your question, we need hard lines. I think one of the things that social media companies do a lot as we're thinking about information policy is that we ask ourselves in our teams, what are our red lines? What are the things that we absolutely do not want to show up? How do we identify that? How do we encourage it? How do we capture it? How do we, and just because I don't believe in banning people from the internet, and I mean not banning anybody, including the people I don't agree with, I just don't think that freedom of speech means freedom of reach. I think that toxic dialogue should be rooted out of large language models. And that's a very human rights frame. So it's complicated and it's difficult, but I think keeping people safe and just going to this slide, if you think about responsible AI, like making sure that our platforms, whatever they are safe, as well as inclusive, and as well as if people are harmed, there's accountability, is a really difficult dance, which is why we need as many people in those conversations as possible, because there are things I'm not looking at that are worthy of attention. I haven't spoken one word about accessibility, and I certainly am somebody who believes that every single person at every single ability level should have access to the promise of these tools.
Hi, my name is Ian Slater. I work in IT here at the library. I'm actually spearheading some of the AI work that we're doing here. Thank you. So my question to you is, what if we get to the end of this and we realize that AI as a technology simply is not good enough to do anything other than reflect back at us our sort of worst, most primal urges? How do we keep an eye out for that? What do we do if we come to that realization?
I think, well, first of all, that's social media is one use case. So I do think that AI systems are incredibly important and powerful, particularly when we're thinking about sorting large amounts of information that we could never, I like to read, but I can never read at the breadth and then sort the information in a way that a system could. So it's two things. I think we need to think about use case. where do we use AI, where do we not use AI? And what I mean by that is, do we need an automated prediction here? Do we need an automated decision here, is the first thing. Number two, where is the human in that loop? I'm sure you've all seen the news of the Gemini, the Google, where it was like the Asian and the black Nazis. Again, I was like, Nazis, nothing to do with me. And then they come up with, I was like, how did I get into this? Nothing to do with me. But what happened in that particular team was that they had automated a system that statistically you could have an outcome of a prompt being equal. So, and they were solving for the problem of the prompt of what does a doctor look like? What does a professor look like? And it's always like this, it's always Ted. And it's like, why is Ted always showing up? Like, Brad isn't gonna get in here, somebody with dark hair. And what it did was somebody asked, what does a Nazi look like? And that had just never been tested for. Had there been a human in the loop, had they actually red teamed it and thought, what are the worst questions that we could possibly ask this? How can we push the system to its limit? And then how can we then engineer for it, but get humans to tag that? We wouldn't have seen that, you know, we wouldn't have seen that. And so that again goes to who's in the room, inclusivity, who's asking these questions. And then the third thing I would say is AI should be used in low stakes situations. What I mean by that is if it's a situation where your rights are not going to be impacted. So for example, in biomedical settings, I'm seeing really exciting things about papers in medicine being processed by AI systems, and they're looking for cures for cancer. So they're trying to figure out what are the warning signs, what should we be looking at? And then that's being presented and that analysis is being used for cures. I absolutely think that that should continue. I don't know anything about food systems, but I'm assuming if you're using AI to make sure that we have good, high quality food and that we will not be a hungry nation in 100 years, 50 years, that feels like a really good use to me.
Thank you.
We have time for two more questions. We have one question online. We are going to go with that one last, and we have one more question here in the room.
Hi, I'm Laverne Bitsy Baldwin. I'm director for the Multicultural Engineering Program here at K-State. And I first want to say thank you for saying, oh, I'm going to get emotional again. I showed up, it took space. I think that's so important for women and multicultural students in this area. So say it every time.
Thank you.
Every time you speak, I encourage you. But I do have a question. You have the slide with the user, the clicks, and then the algorithm in the black box. But you also said time is a key factor in the recommendation system. Can you say more? Time about, so for instance, I see something and I'm like, I can't believe what I just read. So I do it again. I watch that video again. Does that affect things that are out there, or is, what do you mean by time is a key factor?
So I was comparing human intelligence to artificial intelligence, and how when we engineer these systems, we are engineering them to make quick decisions. And the reason that we're engineering them to make quick decisions is that if there is something harmful, if there is a threat, you see this with live stream a lot. I'm thinking of, much of my academic research is looking at disasters online, honestly, like, which is why all my examples are like, yes, when I was thinking about that massacre, I really do have a fun life. That's just my work life. But in the rest of my life, I'm really a fun person. But I do know a lot about like shootings online too. But what they'll do with live stream is that can be switched off within 5 seconds. And that's a very quick decision. And we need that, right? We need to interrupt that. Young people are on these platforms. We do not want them to see this stuff. However, if the algorithm that you're using is deciding whether somebody should go to jail or not, that is a question that, in my view, deserves much deeper deliberation, deserves time, deserves consideration. And though algorithms are being used in that way, but if we think about the way the Supreme Court, for example, will look at cases, they'll sometimes accept a case in October and we won't hear the decision till June. They've taken time. They've looked at the evidence. They've looked at the case law. They've looked at the Constitution. They've made that decision. So that's what I was talking about. And the thing that makes it so dangerous is that we don't know what happens in that black box. We just know that a decision is made. And at least people like me, I'm always looking at the harm. I'm never, in my work, I never look at what went right. I'm always trying to stop things going wrong.
Thank you, Mutale. We have one more question online, so they are going to unmute in room 359.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
I'm Dr. Asif from physics department. So my question is, you said that by design, we need to fix AI such that it doesn't produce racist content. But from Gemini's experience, we already understand that that's not as simple. So is it better that if we use diverse data sets, which are like handpicked by a panel of people? And the second problem that I'm seeing is, what if AI becomes too clever that it doesn't show you instant racism, but it harbors it for a long time. And then when right times comes, it destroys the society. So.
No, those are great questions. And those are honestly things that are being spoken about right now, particularly with Jen and the way Jen works. The first thing I would say is that I was definitely being aspirational. I also want to caution us from not thinking that AI is racist. AI is a tool, it's a bunch of X's and O's. The ways that it's used, the ways that it's applied are what give us those results. But I would say that in those instances, and Gemini is a really good example of where there was no human in the loop. I think just having a history person on that design team who was involved in the testing and evaluation stage, they would have just said, there is no such thing as an Asian Nazi. This didn't happen. This was Aryan. You can even raise up to that position, no less a black person. One person that knew history could have said that. So that's what I think about when I'm thinking about inclusivity. And it does happen in industry that you'll have a multidisciplinary team. So for example, I've been in product teams for over a decade and I'm a social scientist, right? So there is place for that. The second part of your question is what happens if it harbors racism? The way that racism is often being shown up in data sets is through what's called proxies. So I've discussed really obvious examples for the case of this talk, but you'll find that if you use something like zip code data as an input, that will also have a discriminatory output because zip code data is shaped by the racist history of redlining and racial covenants and legal decisions, which are nothing to do with the technology that have shaped and reshaped our environment. And so I believe that if there are humans in the loop, and if you're looking at testing and evaluation with multimodal parameters and inputs, you are going to be able to stop and identify some of that harboring, but some of it is, it's gonna happen and then you're gonna have to pull the switch, which is why use case is so important. I am definitely somebody that believes that the AI is an amazing technology, as quantum will be, as general intelligence, as. However, I think human decision-making, human intelligence should be what guides how we're thinking about these technologies and where we use them.
Very good thought to close today. Please join us in giving a round of applause to Mutale. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have a reception just outside here. Thank you again for joining us for the lecture series. Thank you.